Do you guys know who this guy is?
This is Sizwe Alkaline, formerly known as Reason.
Reason.
This is a Trenta exclusive of note. We have the reason why you love South African hip hop with us. We have the reason why you still listen to Amapiano. We have Mr. Sizwe Alkaline himself. Reason. Hands. Oh, guys. I am literally losing my mind
right now.
Hey, dog, how's it? Thank you for coming through, man. Thank you for coming through, dog.
Thanks for having me, bro.
Hey, how you feeling, man?
I'm good, man.
Yeah. We've been missing you out here, you know. We're excited to know what you're busy with, what's happening with you.
I thought I was all over the radio.
Not enough, though. It's not enough. We want to hear the new stuff, dog. What are you working on right now, man? When should we expect a drop or something?
The drop is reliant, well, in terms of new music for me, I mean, there's a lot of features and collaborations that I'm really working on right now. I think I'm embracing the collaborations, you know. Yeah. I'm embracing, you know, the possibility that somebody has, you know, the magical touch, you know. I think that's the beauty of collaboration, you know. Giving people a collaboration is just, you know, you never know whose stars are aligning, you know, when you create that music. You know?
I feel you, man.
I could be doing a song with you and you could be doing a song with me, and your one is the one that actually takes us to the top, you know.
Yeah.
So right now I'm in that spirit. But in terms of my own project, I'm waiting for the almighty God buddy, Gabs That Is Small, Papta Mangani.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? My whole Imitandazo experience, I kind of felt like, you know, that's kind of like a direction I want to go. I mean, that was really what inspired my, you know, existence and my contribution to the song, you know.
Is
wanting to explore the singing side, explore the tonga side, explore the soulful side of piano, you know, because I think I've done so much rapping. I've rapped, bro.
You've done a lot, actually.
You know what I mean?
There's so much versatility in the music that you make and what you do and how you express yourself, you know.
It's
almost like there's 3-4 people living through you, dog, you know. So it's very exciting for us to look forward to, you know, what else is going to come from you, you know.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I think maybe that's probably, like, going to be my thing for the rest of my career in music until I get to a layer that I, I'm going to try every layer that I haven't done.
Yeah.
You know, I'm going to try every layer that I've done.
That's beautiful, man.
Just to keep, you know, bringing the freshness, bringing the creativity. But besides that, just started up a production company.
Oh, okay.
We just did this deal with Shear, which is a publishing house.
Yeah.
And, you know, some may and some may not know, you know, I do a lot of songwriting
for
a lot of other artists.
100%.
I do a lot of... You know, producing for a lot of other artists.
We've heard whispers. Yeah, we've heard whispers.
Something like that.
Yeah. 100%.
So somehow those whispers have gone to, like, great lengths.
Yeah.
And so there's been a need to actually create a facility that pretty much only produces music for other people.
Yeah.
You know, the same way that I probably need a Gabza to produce my next album. Babda, ke thotse tjhelete.
You hear the tear first, guys.
I think me and my team have done this enough times to realize that this is an opportunity for us to start something for the rest of the game. So, that's something else that's actually been keeping me busy. That's why you don't see me in the clubs, because literally, like, my day-to-day is just hopping from one session to another, just creating music, you know, with other artists and, you know, getting hits done through other people's brands. I tell you, you know, when I came into the game and I was producing, you know, my first projects, you know, Battle Cat, Tongo Garan Tokwa, did a lot of artists and he did a lot of grooming. You know, I think he was grooming me and he was developing me as an artist. He was developing me as a recording artist. He was developing me as a writer. He was developing me as a producer. You know, a lot of the times people... You know, a lot of artists will tell you that I'm one of those artists who, you know, I don't just record, but I sit on the computer and I move files around and I mute things and I create a journey of music from beginning to end because I'm that involved.
Yeah, exactly.
And that really does come from a lot of the artist development from Tongo Gara, you know. And also another gent that did a lot of artist development in my work is Dumi Stogie T.
Hundreds.
You know, when we were producing Audio 3D, which is like my first commercial project.
Yeah.
a lot of those ideas were his.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of the finding the beats was his job, finding the collabs was his job. He literally selflessly, you know, gave his time and his talents to me to just groom me in creating a body of work.
And that's what
that
you want to...
commercially appealing and still relevant within the culture and still keeps within the structures of what makes the culture of what, you know, a respectable artist does within the culture. So,
yeah.
You know, having gone through that, Zubs did that for me. You know, Instro, my closest friends, PH, Raw X, probably one of the best artist developers that people never ever get to talk about, you know, because his house, in fact, that was probably... the first production house that I actually got to witness produce artists, because, you know, a lot of people's first albums were produced by PH, you know, and I don't mean like literally producing the beats, but he was producing the projects, you know, AKA's first projects, Kulichana's first project, KO's first project, my second project, Maclera Dope Boy, you know, A. Reese. These are people who started with him and grew out into the game and became something. I'm literally taking over that space of meeting people as they come into the game, helping them produce and understand the, you know, the business that they're in, but also how to make money out of it.
Yeah,
you know, because there's a trend right now where these kids are finding themselves losing money to people who know more than them.
Yeah,
you know, and that's why it's so important for me to even collaborate with a production house or with a publishing house like Shea, because it's like you guys know these things. You guys have everything that is set up for people in this business to be protected and to survive and to live, you know, instead of just servicing people by, you know, collecting and protecting.
Do we have a name?
Yeah. The name of the company, the name of the company is called Writer's Block. And I'll tell you a funny story. The craziest part about this is that probably the worst part about my company is that...
Yeah.
I actually got that idea from Nota.
Well, he was experiencing some writer's block.
No. Me and Nota were busy talking about the possibility of this. About 2-3 years ago, me and him were like driving, you know, driving around. And, you know, when he was still a very important and sane element of the game, you know, Nota is a very ideas guy. He bounces around ideas. Yeah. And because he's not necessarily specifically, you know, inclined in those specific... you know, industries, you'll hear him talk about how he gave that person an idea and that person an idea or that person stole his idea, because he'd be sharing those things or sharing ideas with people who are in those industries and necessarily he's not, you know? So moments like these where I'm going to talk to you about my production company and I'm going to tell you about the name, and if I don't say, yo, by the way...
He's going to be like, yo,
he's going to be like, yo, I gave Reason the idea to start the company. I gave that nigga the juice. And meanwhile, it's like, no, bro, we were talking about it. But I won't lie, you did kind of land on the name. So this is your plug, bro. At least it's on record. The name. But yeah, man, that's about as close as I'm going to get when it comes to... working with talent and helping.
So basically, it's about giving back, you know, what you have learned and the experience.
Oh, hell no, it's about making money. Fuck giving back, dog. I ain't giving you back shit, dog. Let me tell you something, dog. Fuck giving back. If you're talented and God sets us up and our ancestors set us up, we're working. And we're making money, dog.
Why the fuck not,
but
man?
There's no, yeah. I'm giving back to them. I've got nothing to give back, dog. Hell nah, dog. I've got a lot to make. I'm still in the making. I've got nothing to give back, you know. I don't work with anybody for the sake of charity. No ways. I mean, what would be the point?
Yeah.
What would be the point of me introducing people to this business and educating people about this business if they didn't see the monetary value of it, you know, if they didn't see the end of it? I mean... there is a lot of patience involved. There is a lot of, you know, mental strength, a lot of, you know, focus, you know, practice, consistency, love for the music, and a lot of endurance, you know.
Hold up. I know you're loving the conversation, but that's not the only thing cooking. While talking to Sizwe, we had a young chef cooking the chicken a la Mau Mau on the other side. We got the ingredients because, hey, we still need to bump the cheese up.
get what I did there? Huh? I'm not even supposed to be eating cheese because I'm lactose intolerant, you know. And with that happening, you know, tonight I'm gonna get no sleep. Oh, boom! But we're not here for the food, so let's get back to the conversation.
So, I'd like to know, what do you enjoy in life, man?
Enjoy?
What are your simple pleasures, you know? Those little things that...
Fucking...
Yeah. Who doesn't love
this? Is a trick
though?
Question. Is there a camera in there?
No.
Is there a, like, candid camera out here? I'm joking. Yo, my daughter's in high school. She probably gonna see this. I can't be seeing shit like that.
Simple pleasures?
Yeah. Ooh. It's tricky with me, man. So right now I'm addicted to Ludo.
Okay.
Ludo.
Okay.
It's my...
That's your shit.
It's the craziest thing. Like, I get to, like, break away from... Whenever I need a break, you know, because my life is very much like this, you know, I'm in a place right now where I'm really in work mode. I'm really in work mode, constant work mode. So if I'm being honest with you, in my downtime, I sleep.
Okay.
You know, in my downtime, I sleep. I sleep as much as possible. And when I wake up, I got shit to do, you know, either being a parent, you know, being an artist, being a songwriter, being a producer, being, you know, there's always activity in my life. You know, there's no time off. So. If I'm being honest, like,
yeah,
in my to relax, I sleep, you know.
That
even
is your
even when I say I'm gonna watch a Netflix, I sleep.
Okay.
You know, I'm gonna chill at home and sit on the couch. I'm gonna pass out because I don't sleep enough just from all the workload that I'm dealing with, you know. But in my spare time, like in my little moments, you know, in between a bar, in between a note, in between a, you know, I'm gonna get on my Ludo and play some Ludo. I'm trying my best to visit my friends.
Okay.
In my spare time as well.
Yeah.
I think you can imagine, you know, with the hustle and in our space, especially with the way I'm describing it.
Yeah.
There's never really a time for you to catch up.
That's what I'm thinking.
And go back, you know. So even that too, you know, it's become a thing in my world to, like, you know, just you got some time, hit the hood, you know, for no reason, chill on the block, you know, talk to the bruise, you know. Smoke some, drink some, you know, catch up. Be surprised at how much content comes from that, you know, because, you know, I'm a very real life artist.
Yeah.
The stuff that I talk about.
What is that one song that you're like, this is my masterpiece, this is my Mona Lisa, this is my 16th Chapel, this is the one that will keep my name in the history books, you know what I'm saying?
I have two.
Okay.
I think one is obvious.
Yes.
For obvious reasons.
Yeah.
And then the other one is unassuming. But actually, I'm lying. I'm downplaying it, actually. I think they're both assuming. And it's just they both represent two eras, you know, two pivotal eras in my career, you know. I would say my greatest masterpiece so far would probably have to be Imi Tandazo. For obvious reasons, yes, because it was a big song and it's, you know, it's number one, this, that, and the third. But, you know, there's a couple of things that have happened with this song that have never happened with my song before. And I'm going to go through them. To somebody out there, they might be very, very like, what an idiot. Forgive me.
Nah.
Trigger warning.
Nah.
Idiot moment might be loading.
Yeah.
So, you know, you get a big song. Song plays everywhere. You see the views, you see the numbers, sharp, you know, you're number one on iTunes and everything. But I knew that because of this song, you will never be able to erase me out of the history books, like forever. You know what I mean? Like as an artist, as a backpack rapper that turned into a piano artist and ended up on this song, you will never be able to erase me. And when did I realize this? First time, I saw the song playing at a strip club.
Oh, okay. I know, and then you know that it's...
My brother, this is a prayer.
Bro. Yo.
Like, I'm not talking Sister Petina.
No.
This is not...
This is you, dog.
They're
playing you at the club.
Oh, Nkosi. He's a imitant. But I saw I was watching a stripper.
Yeah.
Dancing to this song. And everybody watching this trip was singing along to the song. I said, this is crazy.
Yeah.
First of all, I was mad that the DJ was playing piano to strippers, but I said, this song is just, wow. Why would you play
anything this song. Else. Why would you play anything else, dog?
Because we are in a strip club, dog!
Hey, bangers are bangers.
It's like, yo, it's a banger, I won't lie. But like, bro, we are there to do... What we're there to do is not necessarily the Lord's work. We're not necessarily on the right side of life, bro.
No, I feel you.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
Probably the last time I ever went to a strip club might have turned me off from strip clubs completely because I was like, there's no way I will ever look at a girl on a pole the same again because I'll just have flashbacks of a girl just literally grinding on a strip club to the part that says, Komele langwana wamino. You understand?
Yeah, yeah.
Second part was, which was much better, you know? Yeah. Then I saw the song being performed at a church. I saw DJ drop the song at a church. I said, I've never really had a song, but not even bump the cheese up, like, nah, bump the cheese up, bitch. I would never play it at a church, bro. You know, maybe do it like, it's so unfortunate that, but not at a church, you know what I mean?
But
like, that song was, I see, I will go, hey, to my shy, I'm a second.
That's both sides of the spectrum, dog. Imagine from strip club to the church, everywhere and in between. I mean...
But it's a crossover, right?
That's what I'm saying. A bang is a bang, dog. It has no moment. It is,
and that was the same...
That's why... That is a perfect example of a timeless song, dog.
But another great masterpiece for me would definitely have to be the No Sleep remix.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Yeah. Because I think that, for me, cultural crossover.
Okay.
You know? It's a cultural crossover. You know, here comes this backpack, battle rap, you know, underground, punchline, rapping-ass nigga.
Yeah.
Right?
With,
you know, doing this commercial, yeah. Super commercial song.
Yeah.
No Sleep as an original did so well. You know,
very well. Peace, it was Thieves, huge. Yeah.
Show Love, you know. Him and Tumi crafted that song beautifully, you know. We put together that song meticulously together the first time. And the remix came in one of the most tragic moments of my life, you know, where I just lost my son. It's like a song like Can't Tell Me Nothing by Kanye West.
Yeah.
I feel like that's a song that you'll hear at a hip-hop gig, like, in my underground, dog. Abu. And then you'll hear it in the club.
It's just
then you'll hear
across
it in the
boundaries. Club.
It's just everywhere.
You know, it's everywhere, yeah, yeah.
You don't know, but Jay-Z, what you do, sure I do, tere.
It works as
those
in
songs,
the movies.
Those
like,
songs are,
wherever
those
you put it,
doesn't
it
matter.
Works.
It's a fucking brilliant
yeah,
song,
yeah,
you
yeah.
know? So No Sleep remix, for me, you know, Pump the Cheese up too, but No Sleep remix for me is like, was literally that, you know.
Halala, the food is here. And real talk, the apples and marshmallows thing also threw me off a bit. But you know what? I roll. Food was a bit dry, but it was good. Don't let the look on Caesar's face fool you. Kitala. But now you know I'm from Limpopo. So anything will work for me. But it's not about me. It's about the main man. So let's get back to it.
How does it feel moving from those humble beginnings, you know, to basically being a household name, having people tattooing your work on their bodies, seeing your work across the world in churches and strip clubs?
Blessed. I think I feel blessed.
Yeah.
Did I ever see this? No, I prayed for it, you know. I prayed for it. I worked for it. I meditated on it. You know, I invested myself in making it happen, you know. So I'm blessed. You know, we pray for a lot of things. We ask for a lot of things. We work for a lot of things. And a lot of the times they don't work,
yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
So, and my whole career literally is something that I work on every day. You know, I'm blessed that it works.
Yeah.
You know, yeah. There's a lot of talented artists out there, just like me. Some even maybe better. You know, who don't get to see their work come to life.
Yeah.
You know, who don't reap the benefits of their work. So to be here is a blessing. You know, and still as well, it's motivation. You know, we tend to undermine self-motivation. Like, we tend to undermine self-motivation. Like, and I guess sometimes it gets stuck in the gloating, you know.
Yeah.
We get too concerned on that one win. And we forget, Guti, like, as great as I am, as amazing as I am, as blessed as I am,
yeah,
like Oskido created a level for me to touch. I'm not there yet.
Yeah.
You know, Bori created a level for me to touch. I'm not there yet. You know, niggas like Casper created levels for people to touch. We're not there yet, you know? Am I at a point where I can put 20,000 people in the room? Maybe I am now. But it's a level that he created.
Yeah, I get what you're saying.
And that's my thing. That's the thing about self-motivation is, you know, I think self-motivation should be that. It should be a matter of, yo, I think now I can hit this level. I think now I can hit this level. I think now I can hit this level. And once you've hit the highest level, you say, now I think I can create this level. And I can create this level and create this level, you know?
Yeah.
And if we look around, there's, our peers are creating levels every day. Whether you like it or not, whether you believe in them or not, whether you approve of how they do it or not, but they're creating a mark, bro. It's, yo, actually, that guy got there. Do I want to get there? Is it needed?
Yeah.
No, not now, maybe later. But if it's now and I need it now, can I get there? How do I get there? You know?
So, what message do you have for a young Caesar? And what legacy would you like to leave behind, you know?
I think a legacy of collaboration and sharing.
Yeah.
You know, I think I, you know, my existence, I've come to learn that my existence is not just for me, it's for others. You know, there's a lot of artists out there who have careers and who have, you know, hit songs and are able to live their dreams because of work that I've created with them, you know, and because of time that I've given to them, because of talent that I've given to them, because of, you know, words that I've given to them. And for me, I live for that, you know. I live to help others. Yeah. I live to create with others. I live to give people gems, you know. A lot of people in my business always fight with me to say, you give away so many ideas, you know. And I'm like, I feel like it's my job. Like I feel like isangoma.
Oh, okay.
You know.
Like, yeah, yeah.
Come to me. I give you the solutions. And but in my consultation, you pay me if you're good.
I was about to say,
in my
about
consultation,
that
you pay me when you're good.
Hey, you know.
You know, I think those rewards are gonna be reaped by my kids. You know,
yeah,
I think people
yeah,
are
yeah.
gonna. I think, you know, by the trajectory of how close we are, and I think because of how successful I plan to be and the
yeah.
way I'm gonna move.
Yeah.
A lot of those blessings won't necessarily be, or those thank yous, or those, you know, those awards or those rewards are going to be for me, but I think they're going to go down to my kids. You know, there's a lot of things that
they'll reap the fruits.
It's like right now, I'm so passionate about working with this kid, Luami. You know, he's Mungile Khumalo's grandson. And aside from the fact that he's talented and he's dope and he's creative and he's able to do anything, but the work, what his grandmother did for me, I'm indebted to him.
Yeah.
You know, and I feel like I've given so much of my life and my talent and my time to so many other people to have time, talent, and life themselves that, you know, I really hope that my kids get the benefit of that. You know, I really hope that someday people are going to turn around and say, yo, you know, that guy did so much for me. I need to do so much more for you.
I feel it, man. It was a pleasure. Thank you so much.
I'm not going to touch you, you Man United hand.
Ah, dog.
And Man United. Why did I take this interview? It's like,
too late now, nigga. Too late. Thank you so much for coming through. I feel like I've learned so much about you.
Yeah.
The wisdom you have dropped throughout, I mean, yeah, it's crazy. But I really appreciate you coming.
Thank you so much. Congratulations.
Hey, it's a blessing. If you love interviews like this, if you want to see way more, make sure that you subscribe, you like, you follow us, and we will see you on the next one. It's your boy, Mpo. It's Reason.
Alakai.
So, Gigi, you're coming back from a hectic night, hectic life.
Listen,
hectic
I was
everything.
This trip.
Yeah.
You need to. You actually need to. So apparently, this is like a thing in the industry, right? You need to have at least one night out with Gigi LeMay, right?